Hey everyone, this is Ricky. Welcome to our Bible lesson today. Aints and saints and do's and don'ts and brothers and sisters and yea and gals and outlaws and whoever else might be listening to the message today, I thank you for listening. Little humor there. All right, this is Ricky. I'm here in Tennessee, Jackson, Tennessee, at a rest area. You can see the background here, and you'll see the trucks way in the background and a truck coming up right here, and you'll see them just to see there, that white truck. So it's pretty quiet here. The last time I've done a lesson was really big and quieter than this, but it's pretty quiet here. So let's go ahead and get into our Bible lessons. Welcome again. Thank you for listening. Thank you for sharing. And that's great. Okay, we're going to take the Bible and show you the Word of God. You say, preacher, what you going to teach on? What you going to teach on? I'm going to teach on the first three religions that man came up with. Okay? That man came up with. First three religions. And God rejected every one of them. But first of all, let's go ahead and do our memory verse. Okay, the last 2 weeks or so, we've been looking at John chapter 10 and verse 28. John 10, 28. So let's look at this verse. Jesus Christ is speaking. He said, "And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand." John 10, 28. Now, this verse tells us that there's eternal security when a person is saved. Now, the problem is many people think they're saved and they're not. But if you're saved, listen to the verse again. "And I, Jesus Christ, and I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand." John 10, 28. Okay, now this next verse that we're going to look at, our text verse, it may be our memory verse for next week, the next 3 to 4 weeks. We're going to look at this verse right here. If you're able to, if you're sitting still or something other and you're not driving or something other, and you're able to turn to Proverbs 28, verse 13. I want you to turn there if you can. Proverbs 28, 13. That's right next to Psalms, okay? So to get the wording, make sure I get the wording, I'm going to go there myself. Memorized this verse a long time ago. It's Proverbs 28 and verse number 13. 28, 13. Here we go. Proverbs 28, 13. This is our text verse for this lesson today. Okay, here we go. "He that covereth his sins," or "she that covereth her sins," either one, "shall not prosper." Okay? "But whoso confesseth and forsaketh them," the sins, that's repentance, "shall have mercy." He can show mercy if you confess that you're a sinner for salvation. And for the Christian that is saved, we're to say, "Lord, your child, your son, or your daughter has sinned willfully. I'm your child. I'm in your hands. I'm saved. But I want my fellowship back." So let's listen to this verse again. Proverbs 28, 13. "He that covereth his sins shall not prosper, but whoso confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy." Shall have mercy. Okay, this verse tells us. What does it tell us? First of all, if you try to cover your sins, and that's what religion does. Let me say a word about religion. I don't talk about religion. You know I don't. I talk about the Son of God, Jesus Christ, His Son. Listen, there's over 33,000 verses in the Bible. 1,189 chapters, 33,000 plus verses, close to 1,000,000 words in the Bible. 66 books, okay? And religion's only used twice, and it's used in a casual way in the book of James. I don't have religion. People say, "Well, I'm not religious." I'm not either. I belong to a person, Jesus Christ, God's Son. But the first three religions that God, that is mankind, came up with, I'm going to show you the first three. So we got to go to Genesis. That's where it all began. And we're going to look at Adam and Eve, and then we're going to look at the third one where Cain brought an offering to God. So first of all, we want to go to Genesis chapter number 3 and verses 6 and 7. So let's go there, make sure we get it word for word, okay? So again, the first religion that man, sinful man, come up with is found in chapter 3. The Bible states this right here. Well, I'm going to read verse 6, and then we'll stop right there and explain. This is Adam and Eve when they're tempted of the tree of knowledge and good and evil. Nothing wrong with the tree, nothing wrong with the fruit. It was in their heart that they disobeyed God, and that's what broke the relationship. And the woman, that's Eve, saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes. That's what Satan wants to appeal to, our eyes. And a tree desired to make one wise. They was as wise as God wanted them to be, and they should have stayed there. She took of the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave also it to her husband, that's Adam, Now, he wasn't no dummy. He knew what he was doing. He knew what God said. Gave it to her husband with her, and he did eat. That's the moment that they were separated from God spiritually. Dead to God, that's what death means, separation. Now watch the first religion. Here's the first religion. And their eyes, and the eyes of them both, were open. They realized they were naked, but most of all, they realized that they were separated from God because of a three-letter word called sin. And you and I are separated from God until we're born again, until we're blood-washed and accept Christ as our Savior. We're also separated. We know of God. We know He's the Creator, and He created us. But in only when you come through Jesus Christ to make that covenant of the blood covenant, to accept Him as your Savior, to save you from sin. Let's read it again. And the eyes of them both were open, and they knew that they were naked. Before, they didn't realize what sin was. There was no shame, no sin. And they, Adam and Eve, sewed fig leaves together, ran from God on the backside of the heaven, probably, on the backside of the Garden of Eden, probably, took some fig leaves, and began to cover their sin. They said, if I cover this nakedness, my shame, my openness, then God will accept me. That's religion, the first religion. Sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. Long story short, God called them out and said, Adam, where art thou? Because they would meet daily in the garden in fellowship. Now, God knew that they had sinned. God knew that. He gave man a choice. He said, Adam, where art thou? And he called him out. And he said, I was afraid. I heard your voice and was afraid. He said, have you ate of the tree? In other words, you're going to try to hide sin from me. You're going to try to cover sin. Or you're going to come out and tell me. He tried to cover his sin. He tried to cover his sin. And the Bible says that the voice of the Lord walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord among the trees of the garden. Now I want you to notice this right here. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, where art thou? Adam, has something broken? Is there a problem now? Yes, there's a big problem. It's called sin. And the sin of us separates us from God. And we run from the presence of God and we try to cover our sins like we've never done it. Like, I'm okay, everything's fine. And you know the rest of it. He began to judge them. But let's go back to that covering of sin. Some people go to church. They go to church on Sunday morning, live like hell on Monday morning through Saturday night. People has told me different testimonies over the years. They'll go out on the town, if you will. They'll go out to the bars, if you will, Saturday night, and be in church on Sunday morning with a hand in the air talking about glory to God. Now, they covered their sin. They tried to cover their sin by pretending that they're somebody that they're not, and they're covering their sin with religion. That's the first religion, trying to cover your sin. You say, well, I'm not like the hypocrite. I've sinned. You're still trying to cover your sin by other people's, and we're going to get to that second, blaming others. But covering sin will not help you on the day of judgment. You are open and you are naked before a holy God that knows your heart. Are you trying to cover sin? Let me put it to you another way. You remember King Saul in the Old Testament? He was the first king of Israel. And the people wanted Saul. God wanted to pick somebody else. But he gave them their choice because that's what they wanted. And Saul was head and shoulders above everyone else. And if you will, he was the masculine, but he was a coward. He wouldn't go out there and fight Goliath. And little old David went out there with a slingshot and killed Goliath. You remember that. God gave him three chances. The last time he was supposed to annihilate the enemies, the Amalekites. And he brought the best of them back in the best sheep and told Saul, that was a prophet, Saul told Samuel, says, Samuel, I've obeyed the voice of the Lord. And he was covering his sin, his covetousness, and he desired the people's will over God's will. And Samuel said, what is this sound of bellowing of goats in my ear? Have you not obeyed God? Yeah, he said, yes, I've obeyed God. And that was the third time, and God said, you are through. And Samuel said, as he turned and walked, Saul grabbed part of his garment and ripped it. And Samuel turned around and said, Saul, God's going to rip the kingdom out of your hand and give it to another that will obey my will. And that would be David. Saul, King Saul, was covering his sin. Do you cover your sins? You say, well, it's not that bad. I didn't mean it that way. I know I look at things on the internet. Uh-oh. What? You look at things on the internet? Well, you know, I just kind of glance through them. I know it's not the best music, but it's okay. God understands me. God knows my heart. Yes, he sure does. You're covering your sin. First religion, they tried to cover their sin. And God said, take them aprons off. And here's what he done. For the first time, Adam and Eve saw blood. He went over there and he got some coats of skins from them animals that he slew. And he clothed Adam and Eve with the coats of skins. And by the way, it wasn't this skimpy swimsuit that you might think about. He covered them because nakedness needs to be covered. America has no shame today in dressing. God said cover up, but don't cover your sin. Confess your sin and forsake of them, and I'll have mercy because my son paid your debt on the cross of Calvary. Let's go to the second one. Second religion. First one, do something. Cover. Sweep it under the rug, if you will. Don't tell nobody my secrets. Man, I tell you something other. Would you want your enemies to know your secrets and the things you've done? Well, I don't either. But God already knows them. You say, well, yeah, but God's a love. No, he's a just God too. He's holy. He's going to punish sin. Don't cover your sin. Number two, let's go. Let's go to this chapter, same chapter. We're going to go to verse number 10. This is when God gives Adam judgment, Eve judgment, and the serpent judgment. And here's what he said. Chapter 3 and verse number... Here's the blame game. Who told thee that thou art naked? Verse 11. Hast thou eaten of the tree? God is speaking to Adam. Thereof I commanded thee that thou should not eat. Verse number 12. And Adam and the man, that's Adam, said, the woman, here's the blame game, the woman whom thou gavest me, how thou gavest to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I did eat. Here's Adam blaming Eve, the one that he took the fruit from, knowing that it would punish them in sin. And he blames Eve. How many people blame, well, if I had society, if I grew up in olden days, if I had the fancy mansion, if I had godly parents. Now, it's good to have godly parents if you had godly parents, and you know what I mean. But you can say, I blame it on my parents. They got enough to deal with, and they're going to stand before God, yay or nay. You are responsible yourself, for your decisions. Don't blame others for your decisions. I got a question for you. Your mom and dad, aunt, uncle, somebody, preacher, teacher, somebody told you not to be going out here and stealing. And when you got ready to steal, did they twist your arm? Did they make you do it? No, you done it on your own. Well, you know, I didn't have the best circumstances, and I didn't know. No, if you come to the accountability age and you have a conscience and you hadn't defiled it yet when you come to the accountability age, you know what's wrong. You blame others. But let's go on. He turns to Eve and he says, Lord God said unto the woman, verse number 13, what is this that thou hast done? And the woman said, this is Eve. Eve said, the serpent beguiled me and I did eat. Now, yes, the serpent was there to tempt. Yes, you may be tempted by your brother, sister, uncle, some backslidden Christian somewhere or another, some ungodly group or somebody. Yes, you're tempted. But God said, no, you're going to have labor pains. You're going to bear labor pains because of your part of what you did. And the serpent is going to get his own judgment. You know, you heard people say, they say, boy, you're going to get it on judgment day. Well, you know what? If you're not blood washed, if you're not saved yourself, you're going to get it too. You're going to get it too. Does that make sense? Am I making any sense to you out there? You can't cover your sins. You can't the playing game blaming. Blame this. Blame the government. Blame this society. Blame this history. Quit blaming others and society and take matters in your own hands. You say, well, I don't know what to do. Get in this Bible. Get in John, the book of John, the book of Romans, the book of Galatians, the book of Colossians, Philippians, and read it for yourself and ask God Almighty to give you understanding. But first of all, you need to be born again, where you can understand the Word of God. Quit blaming others. Then we see that God said to the serpent, number 14, Genesis 3:14, and the Lord God said unto the serpent, this is the snake, representing the devil there, because thou hast done this thing, thou art cursed above all cattle, and above all the beasts of the field, upon thy belly thou shalt go, and dust thou shalt eat all the days of thy life. But I must put in verse 13 there, here's the hope. Here's the one that's going to come and take care of our sins. Verse 15. This is a key verse. Genesis 3:15. Let me read it to you. Here it is. And I will put enmity. That's a go-between. That's a fence, if you will. A gutter. A division. I will put enmity between thee, that's this devil, and the woman. Now, he's talking and Eve is listening. But that woman is none other than Mary, the Virgin. Virgin Mary. Now you can look this up in Isaiah 7:14 and Isaiah 9:6. Okay? You relate these verses, these three verses. Yes, the woman is listening. Yes, she knows the Messiah is coming. But it's also talking about the woman, the seed of the woman. Between her seed and between thy seed and her seed, it shall bruise thy head. And that's what Jesus done on the cross. He defeated sin on the cross of Calvary. Past sin, present sin, future sins. And thou shalt bruise his heel. Yes, Jesus was wounded on that cross. Those nails in his hands and in his feet and in his side and all the marks. Oh yes, Jesus was mired. Sin mires. But he crushed the head of Satan, which represents sin. He crushed sin to give you eternal life with him. Does that make sense to you? Do you understand that? The Messiah was coming. Moses spoke of the Messiah coming. Isaiah, Jeremiah, all the major prophets. And in the New Testament, Andrew, Peter, others said, we have found the Messiah. We found the one that Moses spoke about. And it was Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And John the Baptist said, behold, the Lamb of God. The Lamb of God, the woman's seed, which came through Mary, the Virgin Mary. One that taketh away the sin of the world. So let's review. Number one, they ran to the backside of the garden from the presence of God and tried their best to cover their sin and act like it wouldn't. And God said, no, we got to cover this sin. Took them coats of skins and they saw that blood shed. Innocent, the innocent dying for the guilty. Them, guilty. And Jesus Christ died for us and we're the guilty ones. Number two, they played a game. Blame game. Who are you blaming today? You know, many times when I'm witnessing, I'll say, now, you remember the time when you was 11 or 12 years of age, you look around, make sure nobody wasn't watching you, you was going to see something, go somewhere, look at something other, and as you was getting ready, there was something in your chest getting tight. There was something saying, don't do it. That's the Holy Spirit of God. That's your conscience. That's the witness of God saying, don't do what Adam done, and you've done it anyway. And I tell him, I said, now, Adam's not in the picture any longer. You've chose to sin, and then you practice sin. Who are you blaming? Who are you trying to blame? To make it to work. You're going to tell God, you sent your son Jesus, I sinned, but I'm going to blame it on someone else. Sometimes preachers don't tell the truth. But you know what? It's your duty to find out the truth. You can read the Bible. You can say, God, whoever you are and whatever you are, show me the truth. And he'll show you. In spite of that preacher, if he don't show you the right way, some of them will. A lot of them will, maybe. Some of them tell you to do the best you can. That's not the way. Join this church and we'll baptize you and you'll come up, you'll go down a wet center, and you'll come up a wet center, but we'll try to get you in heaven. Not going to make it. When you bow that will, that heart, that soul, and say, God, I'm a sinner. I've lied, I've lusted, I've disobeyed my parents, I've used your name as a curse word, I've had lust in my heart, I've had anger in my heart, which is the same as murder. I've coveted this, I've coveted that, I've done it my way, but I turn back to you through your son, the Lord Jesus, and I believe he died on that cross for my sins. And I ask that he comes in my life and saves my soul from a place called hell. So, the blame game. Who are you blaming? Number three. Let's go to the next one. We're going to go to chapter four. This is Genesis chapter number four now, okay? And this is where the two boys, Cain and Abel. Cain's the older one. Abel's the younger one. Those boys apparently came to the accountability age and responsible for their own sins about the same time. Logic tells us that. Both of them brought an offering. But we're going to focus on Cain, that third religion. They got ready to give, and Adam and Eve told them, said, now them's coats of skins, was the innocent dying for the guilty until Jesus would pay the debt once for all on the cross of Calvary. His blood would be shed for all sin. We don't need the sacrifices any longer. They knew that. Both boys knew that. Abel went out to the lamb or a ram or some kind of goat, he goat or whatever it was, some kind of animal, and said, there's my sacrifice. There's the blood pointing to Jesus. And he offered that sacrifice from the flock. Here's Cain. He's a gardener. He's got the best watermelons you can see, the best cantaloupes. He's got all the best that you can see. Maybe his turnips is growing great, corn on the cob, everything. And Cain knows better. He said, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to get God the best. By George, I'm going to do this my way. So he goes out there and he picks a watermelon maybe. I don't know how many he picked or how many different ones. But he got those fruits. And he said, now God, this is what I offer. You ever heard the expression? You used to hear it long, long ago. You don't hear it very often. Can't get blood out of a turnip. There's no blood in vegetables. That means that he was doing his own works, his own way. And God rejected Cain. Here's the third religion that started. Cain said, I'll do it my way. I'll take God's word. I'll do it, but I'll twist it around and I'll do it my way. You can't do it your way. This is God's universe. This is God's plan of salvation. And he ordained his son, the only one that could pay our debt. He's the innocent one, dying for the guilty. But Cain said no. And God came to Cain and he said, Cain, why has your countenance fallen? He knew why. Because he didn't bring the right offering. And God rejected it. Cain in a roundabout way said, you don't accept what I do. God said, well, son, if you bring the right offering, a blood offering, I'll accept you. He gave him another chance. The Bible said that Cain went away from the presence of the Lord and did his own thing. Cain refused to bring the right offering, which is an offering pointing to the blood of Jesus Christ, pointing to the sacrifice of the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And he took that blood into the throne room of God, and God accepted his son's blood so that we could turn to God in true repentance. God, I'm a sinner. I'm a sinner from the crown, a sinner to the bottom of my feet. I'm sinning. I cannot undo what I've already done. But I believe that you sent your son Jesus, and I believe he died on that cross for me. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man come to the Father but by me. Jesus said, no, you can't come except through me. And God will accept you through his son's sacrifice, his death, his burial, his resurrection, and his ascension. And he's at the right hand of the Father right now. And he said, I'll accept you. Jesus said, all that the Father giveth to me, opens their heart and shows them, and they accept it. That's our choice. Our part is to say, yes, I believe. Yes, I trust. Yes, I repent. He that cometh to me, the last part of that verse, John 6:37. He that cometh to me, I'll in no wise cast out. Jesus said, he that liveth and believeth on me, though he were dead, and we are dead in trespasses, yet shall he live if we trust Christ and Christ alone. Let's review. You're trying to cover your sin. You're trying to cover it with religion. You're trying to cover it with alcohol. And, oh, I'm not like that. Get out from under that covering of sin. Open up and say, God, I'm a sinner, just like you see me. My heart's wicked, and I believe I turn back to you through your son, the Lord Jesus. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5, we memorized this verse two times ago. He said, there is one God and one mediator. That's between, go between. One mediator between God and men, or mankind. The man, Christ Jesus. You can only come through the blood of Jesus Christ. I don't care how many works you go. I don't care how many times you go to church. I don't care how many times you give to charity. All of that may give you a better moral life, but it has nothing to do with salvation. Salvation is bought and paid for by the blood of Jesus Christ, plus nothing, minus nothing. And you must accept him. Number two, blame. Are you blaming somebody else? Well, I can live a Christian life if they leave me alone. No, a lot of times we get in trouble, self-inflicted wounds. We go out here, we start habits, and we want to blame people. We want to blame God. Well, God, if I didn't have this habit, I got this dead horse or whatever it is. I don't care what it is. The blame game. Quit blaming. And start blaming yourself and say, God, I'm a sinner. I'm lost, like the thief on the cross. He turned to Christ. He said, thou art the Christ. He said, we are in condemnation to the other thief, but this man's done no wrong. And he said, Lord, he recognized him as master, Lord. So my, Messiah. Lord, remember me when thou comest in thy kingdom. Jesus said, today, this day, you shall be with me in paradise. Because he quit blaming everybody else. Oh, the works is against me. The system's against me. No, you are the system a lot of times, most of the time. Sometimes it is a system. But most of the time, I don't care if it is a system, we're still guilty ourselves. Number three, are you trying to hang on your religion because you go to church? You hanging on your religion because I ain't like them hypocrites down there. I pay my tithe, I do this. You pay tithe, you pay tribute, you can give to the United, you can give to the Way, you can give it to the all. You can give your whole life away. If you're not blood washed and accept Christ, you're lost and undone and on your way to a place called hell. But you can say, God, I turn back to you. That's repentance. Not God, I'll do better. Oh, I'll do better than the next. God, I'm a sinner. And I'll be a sinner tomorrow, and I'll be a sinner, but I'm going to trust your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, be a Savior. Hope you've enjoyed this lesson. Please share it with others. And so, give you a little bit more music, okay? Thank you very much.